morning.
Welcome to everyone as we gather to lift up our hearts and give praise and thanks to our wonderful, gracious God. A couple of announcements this morning. We will resume our voters' assembly meeting, special meeting from last Sunday following the service, and we'll get a little more update. Unfortunately, we don't have enough information yet to really start making major decisions, but we'll give you an update anyway. I think that was all that I wanted to announce.
Actually,
okay, Dorothy.
Lois went to Jackson Monticello yesterday. Lois Lennox.
Okay. All right. Lois has been great. She moved to Monticello. We'll continue with our opening hymn, We Lift You Our Praises. Today we are thinking about a man named Augustine. He lived in northern Africa and had quite an influence upon the Christian church and upon Dr. Luther. So we'll hear a little more about that, focusing on God's grace.
Consider our unworthiness.
Almighty
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we confess before you and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as your people, we take refuge in your infinite mercy, seeking your grace for the sake of Christ in saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Forgive us our sins and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We continue with the intro. It is God who executes judgment,
putting down one and lifting up another.
We give thanks to you, O God. We give thanks for your name and fear.
We recount your wondrous deeds.
At the set time that I appoint,
I will judge with equity.
For not from the east or from the west,
and not from the wilderness comes lifting up.
But I will declare it forever.
I will sing praises to the God of Jacob. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
It is God who executes judgment,
putting down one and lifting up another.
Lord of mercy, Christ of mercy, Lord of mercy.
And the strength of the hearts that serve you. Give us strength to follow the example of your servant Augustine of Hippo, so that knowing we may truly love you, and loving you we may fully serve you. For to serve you is perfect freedom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated. The Old Testament reading for this day of the commemoration of Augustine of Hippo is recorded in the book of Proverbs, chapter 2. It is the glory. Remove the wicked from the king's presence, and his throne will be established through righteousness. Do not exalt yourself in the king's presence, and do not claim a place among great men. It is better for him to say to you, "Come up here," than for him to humiliate you before a nobleman. What you have seen with your eyes, do not bring hastily to court. For what will you do in the end if your neighbor puts you to shame? If you argue your case with a neighbor, do not betray another man's confidence. For he who hears it may shame you, and you will never lose your bad reputation. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is recorded in the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 13. Keep on loving each other as brothers. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some people have entertained angels without knowing it. Remember those in prison as if you were their fellow prisoners, and those who are mistreated as if you yourselves were suffering. Marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure. For God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral. Keep your lives free from the love of money, and be content with what you have. Because God has said, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." So we say with confidence, "The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me?" Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings. It is good for your hearts to be strengthened by grace, not by ceremonial foods, which are of no value to those who eat them. We have an altar from which those who minister the tabernacle have no right to eat. The high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place as a sin offering. The bodies are burned outside the camp. So Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his blood. Let us then go to him outside the camp, bearing the disgrace he bore. For here we do not have an enduring city, but we are looking for the city that is to come. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that confess his name. And do not forget to do good and to share with others. For with such sacrifices, God is pleased. Obey your leaders and submit to their authority. They keep watch over you as men who must give an account. Obey them so that their work will be a joy, not a burden. That would be of no advantage to you. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Join to sing the gospel acclamation. I invite you to please sing. Asked the Pharisee, an expert If one of you has a son or an ox that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull him out? And they had nothing to say. When he noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, "Give this man your seat." Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place. So when your host comes, he will say to you, "Friend, move up to a better place." Then you will be honored in the presence of all your fellow guests. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. And Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or relatives, or your rich neighbors. Do so, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Join to confess our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made. For us men, and for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit, the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy, Christian, and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Augustine of Hippo, a city on the northern edge of Africa, he is one of the greatest thinkers that God has blessed his church with. His influence on Christian thought has been profound. Since Dr. Martin Luther was first an Augustinian monk, Augustine's influence even touches us today as 21st century Lutheran. Augustine wrote a book called Concerning the City of God Against the Pagans, or as it has become shortened in our time to simply the City of God. He wrote it in response to pagan claims that the sacking of the city of Rome occurred by the barbarians in AD 410 because the Christian emperors had given up on pagan worship. Augustine responded by stating, to the contrary, that Christianity saved the city from complete destruction. And Rome's fall was the result of internal moral decay. In his book, he paints a picture of two cities, the city of man and the city of God. He describes the city of man as that whole realm of thinking which places its trust in political systems and in false religion. Its inhabitants are those who put their trust in these things. On the other hand, the city of God is inhabited by people who hold to the hope that is offered in the new Jerusalem. That city that we all look forward to moving toward one day. These inhabitants cling to the virtues and values of our Lord Jesus Christ. Augustine makes a sharp contrast between the inhabitants of these two cities. In effect, he challenges us to think about what city we inhabit. He lifts up a vision of eternal peace and blessedness as he contemplates that city of God. He shows how throughout history, God has been marching his people forward to this city. He points out that God's plan is so wonderful, so magnificent, and so grand that the minor setbacks and challenges that we face in everyday life pale in comparison to what awaits us in that true city of God. So, what does Augustine's City of God have to do with our text and with us today? He shows how throughout history, what Jesus speaks about is unique. It's unique to the city of God. Jesus is at the home of a prominent Pharisee having dinner on the Sabbath. Unlike most other times, Jesus is speaking to these people in parables, which even the self-righteous and most hostile of Pharisees is able to understand. You can likely relate to how certain people have too high of an opinion of themselves, and you can imagine the intense embarrassment that someone would feel to be escorted before everybody's eyes from the place of greatest honor down to the place of lowest honor. You probably know people who pretty much only go out of their way or do nice things for people from whom they think they can get something in return. Just think of the number of guest lists for weddings that have been determined by the size of gifts that the people might give to them. Jesus isn't really concerned about telling guests where to sit or telling hosts whom to invite. What he really wants to get through everybody's heads and hearts is the way that they believe, think, and act isn't in accord with God and his way. It isn't the way the truly righteous people behave, because believers are not concerned with self-promotion or self-glorification. Jesus' way is clearly different. And Jesus wants these Pharisees and amazing because of the hymn. The better informed in our society recognize that grace has something to do with salvation, with how or why people receive eternal life. But that's often about the extent of their knowledge of grace. So let's review. What is grace? Grace is God's undeserved love toward undeserving sinners. Now, if I assume that every one of us here today knows this, and if we all confess clearly that we are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, what a wonderful truth that is. Well, even for us, there might be some trouble making the connection. What does grace have to do with what we think and how we live? You see, a believer in Jesus has a completely different idea of self-worth. Most of the world finds self-worth in what one has done or is doing, such as being a doctor, a parent, an athlete, president, hero, or something else. What it is based maybe on what one is, their race, class, height, beauty, brains, etc. Or they find their worth in how one is honored by other people. Salary, rank, privilege, awards, influence. But for the Christian knows God's law and realizes that what he has done and keeps on doing is sin. He breaks every one of his Creator's commands in one way or another and keeps on doing this. Because his sinful nature always wants to go the opposite way from what God desires. Believers know they're sinners, just as well as every other human being on this planet. They understand they're desperately in need of forgiveness and absolutely unable to save themselves. Anyone who follows the way of grace understands we don't deserve any honor from God because our sin and rebellion merit us only death and hell. Understanding and accepting these things does a pretty good job of keeping us humble. It's hard to think too highly of yourself when you realize that you're scum. But this isn't really what makes it possible for a believer to think and act like Jesus. What makes the difference is God's grace. We realize, despite our natural unworthiness, that God loves us. Instead, we see that we have the ultimate worth to him, the Lord, the giver of life, the Lord. Grace also teaches believers who have been given Jesus' perfection to put others first, the same way Jesus did for us. We aren't only recipients of God's undeserved love by faith. We are also distributors of his love to one another. So we love our neighbors without regard for who or what they are or aren't. I suppose I should also add that we love our fellow believers, spouses, and siblings the same way, even when everything your brother does rubs you the wrong way, and you're convinced that he does it on purpose. Even then, love him, because that's how God loves you. You see how radical a change God's grace makes in our lives, in the way that a thinker thinks or a believer thinks and believes? This isn't all the way, or anything near the way, the earth looks, or the world looks like things. We are made different through Jesus. Now those who are in the city of man would expect when they did something good for someone to get something in return. The way of grace is different. Jesus encourages us to do good for those who can't repay us in kind, whether it's feeding the hungry, clothing the poor, or helping the handicapped or injured. This isn't easy, by the way. Our world has us pretty well conditioned to not do anything for nothing. Our sinful nature doesn't like wasted effort helping people who can't return the favor. Once again, God's grace makes all the difference in our hearts, because that's exactly the way God's love works. Think of all the things he's given us, has given us, is giving us, will continue to give us, not only to us, but to everyone in this world. Physically, we have sun, rain, clothes, food, shelter, and countless other things. Spiritually, we have the forgiveness of sins, life, salvation, the Word of God, and his sacraments. Has the Lord given us any of those things expecting to be repaid in turn? Of course not. Once again, that's God's grace at work. People in the city of God have this same love at work in their lives. The opportunities to do so fill your life and are unique to each and every one of you. Maybe it's writing out a check to missions or a charity. Maybe it's inviting the unpopular person a special event in your family. Maybe it's offering a job to a single parent without bothering with references. If you pray about it, God will open up more and more opportunities to be like him in giving to those who can't give back to you. And Jesus tells us, we will be blessed for the love we show and give to others. In the city of God, we live with humility toward ourselves and with love for others, because we live by what we have been saved by. That all-important grace of God shown to us in Christ Jesus. Amen. Now may that grace and peace of our God that pass beyond all our understanding guard and protect our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen. We join in our hymn of response by grace. that as they received his body and blood from your altar, they would eat and drink in true repentance and firm faith, and to their abundant blessing. Strengthen us in all visions to set our hope fully on you, to humble ourselves, and to persist in doing good to the glory of your name. We praise and thank you for all your rich blessings, especially for the mercy you have shared with us in holy baptism. This day we rejoice with those who have celebrated their rebirth day during August. David Yates, Mary Henson, Amy Betcher, Stephen Amelon, Sarah Golson, Raylan Poole, Randy Golson, Austin Friesen, Clara Arns, and Wanda Egemeyer. Continue to bless us each day that we may renounce the devil and all our sinful nature, and seek to let the new person you have created within us arise and live in righteousness and purity before you. We give thanks to you, O God.
We give thanks for your name is near.
Lord God, our shepherd, sustain the pastors of your church in their sacred charge. Establish them in your stead. Make their life of faith worthy of all honor and imitation, and inspire their ears to honor you by honoring them. Preserve all pastors and ministers of your church in the true knowledge of your word and in the holiness of life. Pour out your Holy Spirit on their lips to praise and acknowledge your name at all times and in all places. As they keep watch over the souls entrusted to their care, enable them to comfort and help the weak-hearted and distressed, to raise up the fallen, and to strengthen those who stand in faith in you. We praise you, O God.
We give thanks for your name is near.
O Lord our God, in the creation of Adam and Eve, you instituted and blessed marriage as the lifelong union of a man and a woman, and you commanded that it be held in honor by all as a sacred sign of Jesus and his bride, the church. Give your blessing, therefore, to all husbands and wives, and to all who have pledged themselves to be united in holy matrimony, according to your word, that their lives together in your name may be sanctified by your Holy Spirit, in all wisdom, purity, self-sacrifice, and love. We thank you for the blessings of marriage, especially to Travis and Kelsey, as they celebrate their anniversary. Continue to look upon them with your grace. We give thanks to you, O God.
We give thanks for your name is near.
God of justice, you exalt the humble and humble the proud in your own appointed time. We commend to you the elected officials of our land. Give them the desire to govern as though servant, and give them wisdom and courage to know what is right in your eyes. Follow. Scatter all who devise mischief, and bring the dealings of the violent to nothing. Cast down the unjust from high places. Put far away from us all envious and evil passions, and subdue all haters and evildoers, that this land may have rest before you, and all the people may praise your holy name. By your Holy Spirit, enlighten those who teach and those who learn, that rejoicing in the knowledge of your truth, they may worship you and serve you in their callings. As students return to their studies this academic year, lead them to grow in useful knowledge and Christian virtue. We give thanks to you, O God.
We give thanks for your name is near.
O Lord, give peace and healing according to your will to the sick, the suffering, those troubled in mind, those suffering depression and anxiety, and those with chronic illness and pain, including Alice, Charlie, Ella Mae, Roy, Alice, Brad, Reverend B. and the children that you have entrusted to their care. We give thanks to you, O God.
We give thanks for your name is near.
Gracious Lord, you call on us to practice brotherly love, to show hospitality to strangers, and to remember all those in need. We come to you confident that you will not leave us nor forsake us, but will give us all that we need for this body and life. Bestow on us the full riches of your grace for all the situations and circumstances in which your people dwell, remembering that here we have no abiding city, but that heaven is our home. Give us your aid, that we may, by true faith and godly life, prepare for the coming of our Savior, multiplying your mercy by loving our neighbor in need and loving you with all our body, soul, strength, and will. We give thanks to you, O God.
We give thanks for your name is near.
We entrust all for whom we pray into your hands, asking, Lord, that you receive our prayers and answer them according to your good and gracious will for us.
Amen.
Lord, hear us as we pray in your Son's name and as he has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our closing hymn will be Not What These Hands Have Done. It is number 567. We now continue.